of Samuel, chapter 15, as we read two verses. 1 Samuel, chapter 15. I read two verses, the 22nd and the 23rd verses. Let's hear the word of God. So Samuel said, "Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you from being king." Precious Father, we honor you for the truth of your word. This afternoon, Lord, teach our hearts not to fear, but only to trust and to obey. Teach us to walk with you in the light of word that you have revealed unto us. I pray, my Lord and my God, that you draw us closer unto you. I ask for grace that in simplicity I will share your word. We honor you for your presence amongst us. In the mighty name of Jesus, let the people of God say, Amen. Amen. This afternoon, I'm sharing with us on a message that I have titled, in line with our theme for the year, The Fear of God and Our Obedience. The Fear of God and Our Obedience. In life, as Oswald Chambers rightly said, if you fear God, you do not have to fear anything. Whereas, if you don't fear God, then everything else. Tell your neighbor, let the weak say, I'm strong. If you don't fear God on the other side, then everything else will be your fear. The Bible is filled with the stories of ordinary men and women who, because of their fear of God, who, because of the encounter they had with him, held him in awe, saw him as awesome, and walked with him as the final authority over their lives. Isaiah had an encounter with God and declared, "Woe am I, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." For such men, the word of God was sovereign, and their obedience was total. And for such, not only did God show himself strong on their behalf, God also caused them to do exploits for his people. A phrase that is missing in the 21st century church is the fear of God. The truth is that if you fear God, you will obey him. Jesus says, "If you love me, obey my commandments." The words of the Lord to the children of Israel has become so real in the 21st century church. Isaiah 1:3, when the Lord spoke and said, "The ox knows its owner and the donkey its master's crib, but Israel does not know. My people do not consider." At times, we forget the price of redemption. And if you and I will sit down and survey the cross and the length at which God himself went, sending his only son to come to die a shameful death on the cross for you and for me, if we survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, our obedience, our love, and our fear of him shall be total. The truth is that it is the nature of man to desire to become his own boss. There is a part of us that hates obedience. We don't want to be told what to do. Unfortunately, therefore, today you find in the church people who do not take God seriously anymore. In our generation, divorce has become so common in the church. Today we preach what is popular and avoid what is culturally controversial. Today in the church, fornication, bitterness, abortion has become the order of the day. Where is the fear of God? Now there is no standard for becoming a church member. Come to church, go home. Premarital sex and cohabitation between unmarried couples has become the order of the day. Where is the fear of God? See, beloved, the main motivating factor to walking in obedience should be our love for Christ. If we love him, we will obey him. If you love your wife, you will honor her. If you love your husband, you will honor him. If you love God, if God is supreme over your life, everything that you do will be in line in terms of obedience to his word. We live in an age where people no longer want to pay any price to obey God. We want quick microwave results. And as such, we have heaped for ourselves preachers who tell us what we want to hear. But if you and I will faithfully look back and begin to count the blessings of God over our lives, and where God has brought us from, the children he has given unto us. In this perverted, crooked, and wicked generation, when children are running wild on the streets, God has kept your children intact. You have every cause to honor God and to obey him. The truth is that we live in a fallen world, but we are not helpless. We must understand that obeying God is key to our reverence and fear of him. Our obedience to God will make or unmake us. The truth is that there are some decisions that cannot change our lives considerably. If I go to a restaurant and I'm handed a menu, I have the right to change my favorite diet and to experiment with another diet. That one has no bearing on the total aspect of my life. I can choose and pick. But the truth is that life is about choices. And the choices that you make in life based on who you obey will determine your height in life. But the truth also is that there are some things in life that you should obey if you want your peace. If you genuinely want to live in peace, you must obey the speed laws in the country. You must obey the taxman. You must obey the policeman. But most importantly, if you want to live, you must obey the red light. You want to live? Stop crossing red lights. Including Pastor Kingsley some time ago. You want to be promoted? You must obey your boss. You want a peaceful marriage? Obey your spouse. Our obedience must be intentional. It must be passionate regardless of the cause. If God is our God, where is his honor? The truth also is that often the first effect of obedience is not necessarily a blessing. But obedience always comes with a cost. There is a price to pay to honor and to serve God. Understand that in life, challenges and trials do not mean that we are doing things that are wrong or that we are sinning. Understand that in life, the demotion of man is a promotion of God. The rejection of man is a selection of God. Understand that life is a test. And there is nobody that God has mightily used over the years that has left a right legacy. There is none of them who God did not take through the test. The essence of the test is that not only does it purify us, but it also takes us on a higher pedestal. Look at the life of Abraham. Abraham hears a voice and he obeys God. In the midst of a perverted and idolatrous nation, God speaks. And Abraham is able to recognize that this voice is different. He leaves his father's house. He leaves his people. He leaves his nation in obedience to the voice of God and starts heading towards a place. Because the Bible tells us that Abraham sought for a city. A city which had foundations, whose maker and builder was the Lord God Almighty himself. His obedience became so total that one day God said, I will test this man. You see, when you pass a test, when God tests you and you come out of that test, you yourself are able to give the honor to God and to know that your faith is purified. Take the only son that you love and go to the mountain that I will show you and offer him there as a sacrifice unto me. Abraham takes Isaac, takes the wood, takes the servant. Asks the servant to wait at a place as he and the young boy make their way up the mountain. The young man asks him, Father, Daddy, behold the knife and the wood, the knife and the fire. Where is the sacrifice? Tells him, God shall provide himself for the sacrifice. Binds Isaac. And as he lifts his hand to slit the throat of that boy, in obedience to the word of God, God speaks out of the thicket. Do not lay your hand on that boy, for now I know that you fear me. And by virtue of what you have done, lift up your eyes and look at the stars in the skies. Look at the sand on the seashore. So shall I bless you. In blessings I will bless you. In multiplying I will multiply you. And your descendants shall possess the gates of their enemies. Almost 4,000 years now, that promise still works. Understand that in life, your obedience becomes a memorial to your next generation. And personally, I stand here preaching God's word. I know it is because of the obedience of my mother. Her fear of God, her honor of God, her service for God, and her worship and obedience to the living God. Today, the nation of Israel has every cause not only to bask and to rejoice in the blessings of their father Abraham, but to call Abraham as their father because of his obedience. May you and I pay a price so that our children and our children's children, God can look at our obedience today and honor them in the name of Jesus. The truth is that obedience comes at a cost, but the rewards are immeasurable. Today, as believers, the blessings that comes over us is the blessings of Abraham. Hallelujah. Because of his obedience. Abraham became a friend of God. We sing the song, I am a friend of God. Are we? If we are a friend of God, are we prepared to do what a friend has to do? Look at the life of Noah, ridiculed in his generation because God had asked him to build an ark and God had said it was going to rain. And throughout their generation, it had never rained. And God says, build this ark because I am going to destroy the world with water, with a flood. Noah obeys God and starts building the ark. People pass by him and they mock him and they ridicule him. But Noah kept on as an act of obedience in building that ark. And when the fullness of time came and the flood came, the ark that Noah had built became a safety ark, not only for him, but also for him, his children, and the next generation. I pray that may your obedience to God become an ark of safety that your children can run into in the midst of the wickedness of our generation. In an age where our children are running to become gangs, May the Lord deliver our own because of your obedience in the name of Jesus. Young people, listen to me. The only reason why they will mock at you and laugh at you in school is simply because you have made a quality decision to obey your God. They may call you all kinds of names, but listen to me. When they meet and you are not there, they talk about you differently. They know that there is something different about you. They know that there is an honor, there's a glory about your life that they don't have. Stay put and walk faithfully with your God. Moses encounters God at the burning bush. You and I have seen wildfires before. At least we see them on tele. California and Australia. Very common in Africa. Here, the fire is burning in the middle of a bush. You and I know that when fire burns, that anything that is green is consumed, regardless. But Moses looks, the fire is burning, but the bush is not being consumed. So he says, I will draw near. And as he draws near, God speaks to him through the bush and says, take off your sandals, for the place that you stand is holy ground. And God calls him and tells him, I'm the God of your father Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh that you might deliver my people from bondage that they might worship me. Ha! Who am I? I can't speak. If I go and they ask me who sent me, what shall I say? What is the sign that you have called me? And after God had demonstrated all his powers that he wanted Moses to go and perform, he tells God, send somebody else. But you see, the truth with God is that he sees beyond our outer man. He looks at the heart and he called Moses because he knew that deep down in the heart of Moses was obedience. Hallelujah. So he disregards all his complaints, tells him to throw the stick down, picks it up, throws it down, it becomes a snake, he picks it up, the rod from that day becomes a rod of God. He goes to Pharaoh, throws that stick down, the stick turns into a snake. The magicians laugh. They all bring their sticks, they throw them down, it all becomes snakes. But the snake of Moses swallows. Oh, power past power. Power plus power in the name of Jesus. God himself hardens the heart of Pharaoh 10 times. God causes him to cause miracles to happen. Till the 5th miracle, the magician says, this is nothing but the finger of God. You see, if you walk with God in obedience, people will look at you because God will give you a miracle. People will look at it and they will say that this is nothing but the hand of God. May God give you a miracle that will cause your enemies to clap for you in the name of Jesus. If you look at Moses, his own people did all manner of things against him. They bitterly complained against him. But look at his legacy, regardless of the cost. The price that he pays, the divider of the Red Sea, the deliverer of the people of God from Egypt, the lawgiver of Israel, the price that he had to pay to receive the law, 40 nights and 40 days in prayer. Extraordinary man of God, a man of faith, from a fearful man to a faithful friend of God, called a friend of God, and Psalm 90, a man of God. Why? Because the book of Exodus 33:11 tells us that God spoke to him face to face as a man would speak to a friend. The Bible says that there's no prophet like him. May your legacy after your generation become so great that people will remember you for your fear of God. And when he died, God himself had to bury him because Satan contended for the body of Moses with the archangel Michael. But God would not allow him to have it. You know what? Because if the devil had had the body of Moses, he would have entered into that body and would have caused the children of Israel to worship him. But God himself takes that body and he buries it. Your end shall be greater in the name of Jesus. No man in scripture suffered like Job. But no man in scripture saw the hand of God than Job. His obedience to God cost him dearly. To bury one child is painful. But to bury 10 children one day, the enemy destroyed all his property and touched his health. But remember that in talking about the story of Job, the issue was not about the children of Job. It was not about the property of Job. It was about Job. The devil knows that because he can't touch Job, because of the hedge that God has built around him, and God will not allow it. And because he knew that as long as Job lived, no matter what was lost, it would come back. He attacked him fiercely. Oh, beloved, the battle is not about you. Sorry, the battle is not about your children, it's about you. And as long as you walk in obedience with God, no matter what the devil throws at you, the Lord himself will comfort you and restore in the name of Jesus. Because the devil knows that the moment he gets you, he can just enter your family and destroy everything. So he attacks your property. He attacks your businesses. He attacks your children. But as long as you walk in obedience to God, the God of double restoration will restore back in the name of Jesus. My friend, Pastor Eastwood, the battle was not about Amanda. The battle was not about Audrey. The battle was about Eastwood. And the devil knew that the impact that Eastwood had made in the northern center of Ghana was so much. And because he couldn't touch him, the only thing he had to do was to spill his venom on his children. But Eastwood still stands strong in the name of Jesus. Because as long as you live, your siblings are protected and God is able to restore in the name of Jesus. The devil attacks my friend Pastor Pasha, who is here today to give thanks to the Lord. Because of his fear of God and his determination to bring the unsearchable riches of Christ to his generation, sends the doctor here to study, passes with distinction. The devil touches that girl with the intention of destroying Pasha. Even though Hanslin is gone home to glory, as long as Pasha lives, any honor that God determined for Hanslin will come double portion over the siblings in the name of Jesus. The battle is about you, but God will not allow the devil to touch you. As long as mom and dad are obeying God and are standing in the gap, the aim of the devil is to somebody went and sought for a kinship for one of these chiefs that does not belong to them in Africa. Then the owner said, we will see. I will destroy your ancestors. I will destroy every male in this house. And in less than 3 years, over 4 boys have died. But thank God for Jesus. Had it not been for Christ, the altars in our families would have consumed us. As long as you stand put for Jesus, regardless of what the devil throws, it will not touch your children in the name of Jesus. May the Lord protect you and your home in the name of Jesus. Look at the life of Joseph. Joseph moves from favorite son to a slave because of his vision and because of his dream. But you see that when they were taking that coat off him, we don't hear of Joseph fighting back. His silence indicates character. Sold because of his dream. Serving in a house where he should not be simply because of his dream. Stripped of the coat of many colors, but they could not strip his character off him. You see, no matter what the enemy throws at you, the only thing he can take from you is your heart, your character. And understand that God does not look at the things around you, he looks at your heart. I pray, may somebody rise up and live for Jesus. Amen. And pay the price. Obedience comes with a cost. If you make a quality decision to walk with God, there is a price to pay. But you know what? God will honor you. He will honor you. And when God shows up, the world will know that you serve a living God. That is when they will say that there is no God like the God that Pastor Kingsley serves. There is no God like the God that Mercy serves. May it be said of you in the name of Jesus. But be willing, nobody walked with God without paying a price. Understand that we live in a fallen world. There are so many altars in our homes. There is so much witchcraft in our generation. And if you make a quality decision to stand out, know it's a battle, but God will protect you. Yes. I didn't hear you. Yes. I said, but God will protect you in the name of Jesus. Yes. They stripped him of his coat of many colors, but they could not strip that character that was inside him. That is what God looks at. So in the house of Potiphar, anything he lays his hands on to do prospers. Potiphar's wife tries to give him a scholarship he will not take. How can I do such a wicked thing against my God? They throw him into prison. Even in the prison, Joseph was made the head. Understand that there is nothing that happens in our world that God does not see. Oh, you are not here today. There is nothing that happens in your life that God does not see. God looks at your heart. If your heart is obedient towards him and his word, none of us is perfect. But God knows something for sure that if a man, a woman makes a quality decision to serve him, he will pay every price in the name of Jesus. Today, we talk about Joseph with joy, with honor. We see him as a man of dignity. The man of forgiveness. From prison, God takes him straight to the palace to become a prime minister. That is what obedience can do. That is what the fear of God can do. And today the Lord asks us that if you fear me, where is my honor? Your loyalty to the word of God and obedience to the word of God will always open a door of elevation for you. Look at King David. A young shepherd boy, minding his father's sheep. God's eyes goes to and fro over the whole earth to show himself strong on the behalf of those who love him. He finds David and calls him a man after my own heart and sends a prophet of his generation, Samuel, to go and to anoint him as the next king of Israel. All this time, Saul was the king. And the Bible in scripture, David was the only king who was anointed. The Spirit came on him and permanently stayed on him. The sweet psalmist of Israel. The man of prayer. The man of worship. The man who genuinely loved God. David was not perfect, but he knew how to obey God. David would never do anything without consulting God. David will win a battle. The next battle, he will go on his knees and he will consult God. That is what God looks from us. Not a people who believe that we've made it, we've arrived, and we can do things anyhow. But people who will acknowledge him in all that we do. Today, the legacy of David is that the flag of Israel is the Star of David. The best hotel in Israel is named King David. And there has never been a king like him, and there will never be any like him. He prays to God and says, I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplication. Because he has inclined his ear unto me. Therefore, will I call on him as long as I live. Psalm 1 says verses 1 and 2. He loved prayer, loved worship, hated every false way. And when the children of Israel sinned and God wanted to punish them, God will say, but for the sake of my servant David, may your obedience be such that in the future when your children stumble, may God remember your obedience. Amen. And forgive your children. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. I think that Elijah is a man we've all come to love. Faced so much intimidation in his generation, but stood up because of obedience against the sinful nature of his age and generation. You know, beloved, the challenges of the 21st century is such that it calls for boldness. It calls for men and women who will stand in the pulpit. It calls for young people who in the midst of wherever they are will proclaim that Jesus is Lord. Stands before King Ahab and tells him, there will be no rain or dew except by my word. Locks heaven with his prayer and his proclamation. Today, when we talk about Elijah, we remember him on the Mount of Transfiguration. I pray that the legacy you will leave will be so much that God himself will be proud of you. Look at King Jehoshaphat. When Judah was surrounded by the Ammonites, Moab, and Mount Seir, with the intention to overtake the city, he calls the people and proclaim a fast. And as they prayed and worshipped, God speaks through the prophet Jehiel. And God speaks and God tells them, do not be dismayed or do not be afraid of the army that you see. For the battle is the Lord's. May the Lord fight for you. If God sees your obedience, your battle becomes his battle. Hallelujah. Raises the Levites, they lift up the song, for his mercy shall endure ever faithful, ever sure. And the Bible says that as they sang, God began to set ambushes amongst the enemies. The people of Moab turned against the people of Mount Seir. You are from Judah. And they killed themselves. And when they finished, those that were left turned around and fought those against Mount Seir. And the next day when they went, God himself had fought for them. Beloved, walk in obedience. Because there are some battles being waged in the realm of the spirit that you have no clue. Oh, are you here today?
Yes.
Understand that anything that is manifested in the flesh had already taken place in the spirit. But as you walk on planet earth faithfully with God and seek his face in obedience and obey the commandments of the Lord, if God says honor your wife, honor her. If God says love your wife, love her. If God says submit to your husband, submit. If God says children, honor your parents, honor them. Simple obedience. If God says a tenth of everything that you have, give it to me and test me. Do it. Come on, obedience. Peter was a master fisherman. Had fished all night. In broad daylight, Jesus tells him, launch into the deep. Oh, my word. And for those of you who have been to Galilee, you'll see that Sea of Galilee. He launches, and the bumper harvest he had was such that the other fishermen had to come and help him. It's obedience. Obedience. And in our walk with God, all that God requires of us is obedience comes with a price, but obedience also brings rewards. God calls the Apostle Paul out of nowhere. A persecutor of the way, but God gets hold of him and stands before King Agrippa and says that, therefore, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus and in Jerusalem and throughout all the region of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent, turn to God, and do works befitting repentance. For these reasons, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. Therefore, having obtained help from God, to this day I stand witnessing both to small and great, saying no other things than those which the prophets and Moses said would come. No apostle suffered persecution than the Apostle Paul. But today, look at his legacy. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. He shaped our theology for us. His intelligence was so mightily used by God. And today when you talk about Paul, those that love Christ honor him. They call the apostles, they assemble them, and they warn them. You should no longer preach the name Jesus. Oh, my goodness. You see, one thing about Paul is that when he was placed in prison, it gave him the opportunity. You know, there are some letters we call the prison letters. The epistle to the Colossians, to the Philippians, to Ephesus, and Philemon were all written by Paul when he was in prison. And understand that at times, when such challenges come, God only wants to use them for his glory. Understand that all things work together for our good to those that love God and to those that are called according to his purpose. They call the apostles and they tell them, you should no longer preach in this name. And they asked the Sanhedrin a very simple question. Who should we obey, God or you? Answer for yourselves. And they come back to their own after they've been beaten, and they prayed. And the Bible says that the foundation of the building shakes, and they are filled with the Spirit again because of their toil, their commitment, their obedience, and the fear of God. Today, this gospel has been preserved, and we also have become partakers of the inheritance of God. Your obedience will leave a testimony. And my prayer is that your obedience to God will be such that when the history of your generation is written, your name shall be there in the name of Jesus. Let me end by saying the truth that as you walk with God in obedience, there are benefits. The first benefit of your obedience in terms of your fear of God, is that it helps you to enter into your promised land. And for every one of us, there's a promised land into which God has ordained us to be. You will get there in the name of Jesus. Amen. Caleb obeyed God at a time when all the other spies brought an evil report, he alone and Joshua. And you know what? In their generation, only the two of them entered into the promised land. Because God himself says, except Caleb the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, and Joshua the son of Nun, for they have wholly followed the Lord. To wholly follow the Lord is to obey God in every aspect of his word. The second thing is that God fights for you. The God who fought and stood up as a captain of the host of the Lord's army and fought for Joshua and the children of Israel, that same God will fight for you in the name of Jesus. Asa obeyed the God. Asa obeyed God, and the Lord himself was his master. The God who fought for Jehoshaphat, may that same God fight for you. But also understand that obedience brings divine elevation and honor. Any promotion you want, obey God's word. Make him your fear. The psalmist David says, Psalm 119, verse 5 and 6, oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Then I would not be ashamed when I look into your commandments. As you look into the commandments of God and do them, it takes shame away of your life and it brings elevation and honor. May the Lord promote you. Amen. But understand that it also brings eternal blessings. We will be rewarded for our obedience on the judgment day. Anybody that has made a quality decision to walk with Christ and to obey him, your reward is waiting you. But it also matures us. The more you obey God, the more God himself moves you into maturity. But not only that, it also brings stability and peace in our lives. David sings Psalm 119:165 and says, great peace have those who love your law, and nothing causes them to stumble. Your word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you. You see, the fear of God, your obedience to God brings stability and peace in your life. The moment you make God your fear, you don't have to fear anything because you've already made your decision. You've made the decision that regardless of what, when the bells of sin ring, I will not follow. And because of that decision that you have made, it brings stability and peace over your life. But it also gives us deliverance from the traps of the enemy. Psalm 119:105, the Bible says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a lamp to my path. The word. Your obedience to the word of God will make it a lamp. What that verse simply means that as the enemy sets those traps, the word of God will just reveal them to you in the name of Jesus. From today, may the word of the Lord guide you. May the Lord himself frustrate the devices of the crafty so that they are unable to perform their enterprise in the name of Jesus. They will gather, but the Lord says, it is not by me. When they gather against you, may the Lord himself thunder in their midst in the name of Jesus. From today, may the Lord himself open unto you his treasures in the heavens. From the north, south, east, and west, may the Lord himself begin to draw favor. May favor begin to locate you in the name of Jesus. But my last point is that your obedience to the Lord will give you divine guidance. We live in an age where many of our young people don't know what they want. I will do that. Some have also discovered what they want to do, but they don't know what they have to do to get there. And as you obey God's word and trust him, Proverbs 3:5-6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, the Bible says, acknowledge him and the Lord shall direct your path. I pray that may the Lord direct your path. Amen. I didn't hear you. May the Lord direct the path of your children. Amen. May the Lord himself direct the path of your future. May the Lord himself, the restorer of all our broken bridges, open the heavens afresh unto you and begin to restore as he directs you. May your obedience make room for you. May your fear of God draw closer to him. Again, may the Lord give you a tangible miracle that will cause your enemies to clap for you. Come on, can I have a witness in the house? In the name of Jesus. Glory to God.